ओम सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ओम शांति शांति शांति। समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। ओम श्री चिन्मय सद्गुरवे नमः। योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचां मलं शरीरस्य च वै त्यकेन योपाकरोत्तं प्रवरं मुनीनां पातंजलि प्राञ्जलिना नतोऽस्मि। हरि ओम। वी आर इन दी साधना पाद ऑफ पतंजलि योग सूत्र। द फोकस on the current sutras is on karma. Karma, karmashaya, karma vipaka. The beauty of Patanjali Maharaja's Yoga Shastra is it hits the bullseye when Patanjali Maharaj dwells into the depths of karma, the causative fundamental reason of our entire existence and the painful, sorrowful presence on this earth. Some people may argue that life is not all that bad. It's nice to have wife, children around, eating nice delicacies, going for a long walk or a long ride, watching some nice serials and enjoying the comedy or tragedy on the stage. So sometimes we do get a feeling that what is bad in life? Life is all not that bad. Yeah, it is an admixture of sometimes the painful things are there, but it's not that bad. This is a general feeling we have, or outlook we have towards the life. Patanjali Maharaj has dealt in detail about this feeling also. This so-called feeling of happiness that we have in our life is also a klesha. In fact, Patanjali Maharaj mentions, and a yogi sees nothing else than dukkham in this world. Why he said so, we are going to see in detail. But before that, it is important and imperative, mandatory, to note that how the karma functions. We usually have a feeling that the troubles that we are getting are because of karma. The fact is, it is the trouble that is giving rise to karma. It is head side down. The understanding goes topsy-turvy here. It is not the kleshas that are born out of karma. It is the kleshas that give rise to karma. We need to understand this very clearly. We have seen what kleshas are. अस्मिता अविद्या राग द्वेष अभिनिवेश इति पंच क्लेशः. We know, we have seen in detail what these five kleshas are. The ignorance, the fundamental ignorance, avidya, the ego, asmita, ragadvesha, anukula, pratikula response to the happenings around is raga and dvesha. A particular response is dvesham. I don't like this man. I don't like this situation. I need peace of mind. There is too much chaos around me. I wish I could have had this. I wish I could have had that. This is all dvesham. Anukula pratisada is sukham. I wish I could have it more. I wish I could have that also and this also. Sukham. And the fear of death. The very basic feeling that I should never be dying. I should always be existing. I and my presence. And mind well, when this thought comes to me, I'm not interested in others being alive. That is a secondary or immaterial. I shall not and I should not perish. I should carry on forever. Why do you think a 90-year-old or an 80-year-old politician is still interested in doing the politics and preserving the power, the satta? Is because he feels he's going to live forever. A saintly person always has a feeling in his mind that, oh, this is going to die, including my body. So saintly people are always constantly alert and aware of death, while the common man is constantly unaware of death and works, feels, does everything as if he is going to last forever. How ironical it is that every one of us know that we are going to die. And yet, every moment is pulsating with life. It's a very surprising thing that never it comes to the mind. Have you seen any person sitting marooned saying that, look, after another 20 years, I'm going to die? No, not a single person you have come across, including yourself and myself. The reason being, we have an inherent tendency to keep the death on the sides. Although it is inevitable for everybody, including the Jivan Mukta. Everyone is going to die. No one has lived for 200 years. Even Upanishad says, Jijivishet Shatagam Samaha. Live for 100 years. That is what Upanishad says. And Upanishads are Vedas, the words of truth. So that means max you can reach up to 100 years, but still you feel it's far away. This is called abhinivesh. Now these pancha kleshas are the originator of the karmajanya samskara, not the karmas. Let us take an example. Somebody gave you a burning sensation with a hot rod. What happened? The karma is the rod was hot and it was applied to the skin. Is the karma part of it? Is there anything wrong in the karma? Nothing. What is wrong? when the burning sensation comes to the skin, immediately we think, ah, I don't want this feeling to come. Dvesham. The klesha started. Because now the mind is thinking and desiring that such kind of situation should not be happening again, that klesha becomes the originator of karmajanya samskar. That means, I want to be at a place where there is no burning sensation. So that means the klesha has given rise to the desire. The desire of having something or not having something. Anukula or pratikula. Now take this analogy in a little beautiful manner in our own life. Let us say we are driving to the office. What is the karma? The karma is you are putting your hands on the wheels and you are going to the office. This karma will not result in any phalam if I do not succumb to the kleshas. Now, what is the klesha? Somebody came and overtook my car in a very bad manner, and immediately the mind says, hell with that chap. Klesha. He didn't want that situation. Pratikriya. The response of avoidance came. The klesha got originated. The klesha that got originated is the harbinger or the originator of the karma phala janya samskar. So the crux of the matter is, irrespective of the karma that is happening, which again is the result of the previous karmas, while doing the present karmas, we must ensure, and here comes the explanation of Gurudeva coming again and again in his explanations. He always uses a word, life is meant for vasana catharsis. It is for the vasana virechana. Because of the previous vasanas, you have got this birth. While this birth is happening, while the action is happening, if we look towards it as only the virechana or catharsis of vasana, then we must ensure that this particular karma that is happening as a virechana of the past karma does not create again the kleshas. That means if we have a klesha virahita karya, klesha virahita karma, then there is no chance of building again the karma. And to have an attitude towards a karma in this manner, that this karma should not create new kleshas, is possible only when you have a viveka buddhi. And to have this viveka buddhi, you require vikasa of antakarna or the chitta. This chitta or antakarna is not developed or is not vikasi bhuta in lower animals. That is the reason why the human birth is the pinnacle of all births, because you are able to decide viveka. Which dhatu, select between the right and the wrong, shreyas and the prayers, that which is likely to create the karma, and then take a precaution in time so that none of the karmas that are happening in my life produce a samskara, which will be again the reason for my again taking birth to exhaust these karma janya samskaras. That being the case, the sutra is klesha moolaha karma shayo drushta janma vedaniyaha. What it means is klesha moolaha. The origin is a klesha. Karma moolaha nasti. Klesha moolaha asti. Klesha is the one who is the root of karma ashaya. Now let us be very clear about this word karma ashaya. Karma ashaya means collection, collected, pulling off karma. It's an ocean. The analogy given in Vachaspati Mishra and Vijnana Bhikshu in this commentary is, it is like the fish net of a fisherman, kuli ka jaal, machhware ka jo jaal hota hai, the net you have of a fisherman, it has multiple knots and it keeps on spreading everywhere. In the similar manner, each karma that we do creates a thing called karma janya sanskar. Mind well, sanskar is very important. Karma is not. What is the meaning? The meaning is just, it is not the jalebi that you eat that is important. What you felt is important. Ah, such a beautiful thing called jalebi. So jalebi is immaterial. Karma is immaterial. What it has resulted in, samskar, impression on the mind, the mental impression is most important. Because when you have mental impression, because when you have impression on the mind, you have created a samskar. This samskar is what is going to give rise to the vritti. You have planted a seed. Now it is bound to sprout. So what is the key or the crux of the yogi? Yogi does the karma, does not let the samskara come out of it. This is where we can take a brilliant analogy of Gurudeva. He loved Srikhanda. He had a predilection for the Srikhanda. And it's not that he didn't enjoy it. He ate it and enjoyed it. But it did not result in any samskar on the mind. No seed. So no another birth for having such a pleasurable feeling called Srikhandam. That is the difference. When a act or karma or a karya fails to do any impression on the mind, such an yogi's mind and his samskara is called dagda bija samskara, the samskaram of burnt seed. A burnt seed will not sprout. It's a bit ironical. You have the experience, but it is not creating impression. Impressionless experience is the yogi's life. And our life? Life full of impressions obtained through experiences. That is the sum total of our life. Every now and then, every moment, right from morning, right here, right now, when you're listening to the explanation of Patanjali Maharaj, in case it is difficult to understand what comes to the mind, hell with this, how difficult and complicated this Yoga Shastra is. On the top of it, Dr. Jadhav is trying to make it more complicated. And when you think like this, what has come to the mind is an impression called hatred. I don't like it. It's so too difficult. Dvesha Purna Pratisada. When you have Pratikriya of Dvesha Purnata, you have already created a samskar. In fact, Patanjali Yoga Sutra Pravachanam has resulted into another samskar, which would mean you will be born again for this samskar. It is so ridiculous. The life is tuned to this samskara. Why are so much tuned? Because, sir, we have been, Maharaj, doing this for births after births. Millions of births we have taken and we have accumulated these samskaras, and the ability to manufacture these samskaras. Every time there is an experience, there is a samskara, and that samskara is karmajanya samskara. So when we say susamskruta or asamskruta, both are bad. Vigata samskrutaha is the best. Nothing creates an impression on the mind is the state of a yogi. For him, the world is dead. Does, when a father participates in small children's play, in a happy birthday party when few children are enjoying, we also become a party to it, clap and sing and everything. But what is there in the mind? Nothing. We just say that, bachcho ke liye kar raha hu. I am doing it for the sake of the kids. It doesn't create. Do you feel sad in that particular thing or good in that? Both you don't feel, because you feel, oh, my child is feeling better. Let's continue. Similarly, बजिचाए अतफाल है दुनिया मेरे आगे होता है शबे रोज तमाशा मेरे आगे. A Sufi says, like a children's play, this world keeps on setting up when I wake up, and the world is set off when I sleep. या निशा सर्वभूतानि. That shloka, what does it say? When everybody is awake, the yogi is asleep. The reason being, he does not let any of the experiences of the world to create karmajanya samskar. This karmajanya samskar, one karmajanya samskar is created, it goes and fills the pot. The pot is called karmashaya. Then I go to the office and I find that my tea has not come. I call the person saying that samajh mein nahi aata, I have already arrived, you have not given me the tea as yet. Another karmajanya samskar added. Then you start working for the first paper of the office and you say, how the hell this report has been prepared? Another karmajanya samskar has been added. Then you say that, you know, you're actually sitting in the office looking at the paper, but you're thinking about how can I make my house beautiful. Third karmajanya samskar is added. Then you think that, can I have some biscuit with the tea? Fourth karmajanya samskar is added. What is happening? A continuous manufacturing of karmajanya samskar leading to the pot. Then what happens? Karmashaya becomes ruddhingata. There is fattening of karma ashaya. So this karma ashaya is now fattened with what? Karma janya samskar, which are of two types, dharma and adharma, or papam and punyam. You felt like helping a very destitute person, so you went and told him, take this 100 dirhams and take care of your clothes, etc. What happened? Again, a karma happened, but a good karma happened. Sorry, sir, good or bad, karma has to give you phalam. So a good karma has to give you good phalam, bad karma has to give a bad phalam. For a yogi, there is no good and bad, either of the karmas. So when this good karma happens, it is punya. So in that karma ashaya, the pull of karma, a good, a small chit on which it is written, this man has done a good karma, is dropped into it. Then you go and shout at somebody, especially wife. This man has shouted at his wife, bad karma, it is added to the karma ashaya. once this is done, then because of this good and bad deeds we keep doing, why do you do a good deed? You feel good about it. Why do you do a bad thing? Because you have aversion about that thing. So, kama, krodha, moha, lobha. Kama, krodha, lobha, and moha. These are the four modalities of operating of the karmashaya. If these four are not there, karma cannot be there. Because klesha becomes absent. If klesha is absent, then kama, krodha, lobha, moha cannot be there. If these four are not there, then such a karma is called defunct karma. So it doesn't lead to anything. So nothing is added to the karmashaya. Now perhaps we will understand why repetitively Shastra has been insisting that please do not fall prey to the indriyas, because the samskaras made by indriyas add to the karmajanya samskaras. That is the reason why repetitively during the lectures and the discussions we keep saying that do not increase WhatsApp, do not increase friends, do not, because every increment means one person added to the friend circle is adding millions of karmajanya samskara, because with that person we will have love-hatred relation, interest relation, this relation, that relation. All will lead to karmajanya samskara. Now we understand why the yogi prefers to be in solitude. Either be in people but remain isolated within, or don't get too much involved in this world, because indriyas are constantly working for creating karmajanya samskar. Now, while doing this karma, if I am doing a karma with intensity, not everybody's life is not a life of intense karma, but some people, it is a life of intense karma. Adolf Hitler, intense karma. Ravana, intense karma. Similarly, Gurudev, very much tapasya, intense shubha karma. So when a karma is done with tivra dharma bhavana, intense good feeling, such as mantra, tapasya, samadhi, ishvara, devata, maharshi, mahatejasvi, purusha, aradhana, that means if you do tapas with intensity, it is called as tivra dharma bhavana karma. It gives phalam in the same birth. Saumya dharma bhavana, the phalam can be into the next birth or the next or the next or the next. For example, you are drinking tea and you say that it is good if I can have another cup of tea. You will either get it, and suppose you don't have money, you will not get it. But the desire remained. That desire gets fulfilled in the next birth. Wherever you are born in human body, you will be again getting tea from somewhere. So it is a saumya bhavana. Intense bhavana, all sexual desires, when they are too intense, that lead to abnormality in the current life only, because of intense bhavana about adharma. Similarly, tivra klesha adharma bhavana, like Ravana, like Adolf Hitler, like Nadir Shah, who massacred entire Delhi in one day. And that too, what did they do? whenever you do operation, O double P, or not operation, oppression, when you are doing julam, when you are to whom? A scared person, bhayabhita. There is somebody who is scared, the animal is scared, and you are trying to kill. Then, pitiable people, dayadra. There is a beggar, and you'll head, go away. You stupid fellow, I'll give you a slap. Or straight away beat him with a stick. Mind well, this is tivra klesha adharma bhavana. And the worst of the tivra klesha adharma bhavana is insulting a rushitulya person. Very easily we say, oh, that rishis are, they are all stupid, you know, they are all surviving on society, stupid people, don't want to work. Never say that to a sannyasi, because you are insulting a rushitulya purush. You know the kick that was done at the Bhrigu Rishi, it resulted into what? So that being the reason, Tivra Klesha Adharma Bhavana gives Shigra Phalam in the same. That is why all those people who are extremely corrupt. Currently, there is one case going on in the TV news channels. There's one corrupt person who caused the death and tormentation. That's why in the same birth, he is being taken for a task. So, karma janya samskar gives rise to karma ashaya, collection of karma janya samskar, which are either dharma or adharma, papatmak or punyatmak, which give rise to kama, krodha, lobha and moha. Now this karma ashaya pull, from this pull, there are two types of karmas that are brought out. One is drushta janma vedaniya. Drushta janma vedaniya means our current life. It is, you can see it. So drushta janma vedaniya, that which is demonstrated by birth and experienceable, is called drushta janma vedaniya. In short, the present life. Adrushta janma vedaniya, because there is a lot of pull of all those samskaras still sitting there, there is yet time come for the ripening of those karmas. So that which is lying there in the warehouse is called Adrushta Janma Vedaniya. That which has come to the showroom is called Drushta Janma Vedaniya. These are the two types of karmas present in the Karmashaya. And then comes the next sutra, sutra number 13. Sati Mule Tad Vipako Jati Ayuhu Bhogaha. Sati Mule, Klesha Rupi Mula, that Mulam, Sati Mule, because of that root, which root? Klesha. So Klesha Rupi Mulam causes Phalam in the form of Jati Ayu Bhoga. So Karma, Karmajanya Samskar, accumulation of Karmajanya Samskar is Karmashaya. From that Karmashaya, whatever is taken out for the present life is called Drushta Janma Vedaniya. And that particular Klesha, the Kleshas which cause the Karma, is the root of this birth. The birth is called Vasana Catharsis. The birth is called fructification of past Karma. And this particular fructification means vipaka, visheshena pakvati, that which is ripened specifically for this birth, it is called karma vipaka. Now, how much of my karmas have come for this particular karma vipaka? That is the discussion, that is the subject of discussion. Understood that from my past karma, this birth has come to me. But a fundamental question asked and discussed is whether my past one karma causes me one birth, or one karma causes me many births, or many karma causes me one birth, or many karma causes me many births. Let us see one by one. Can one karma cause one birth? And the Bhashyakar says that is not possible. Why? Because karmas are so many, they are done every moment. So if one karma is going to cause one birth, how many millions and billions and billions of births also will be inadequate? And then what will happen? For the fructification, to give the phalam of that karma, the time gap will be so large that the correlation between phalam and the karma is impossible. So it is atarkika. That is why one karma cannot cause one birth. So one is outrightly scrapped. Second is, can one karma cause multiple births? It is not possible, because one karma, if it causes multiple births, that means the person will be born in one or two or three or four or many yonis at one time. So that means one karma caused a person to become a rat, a cat, a horse, a man simultaneously. That is absurdity. That is also not possible. Can many karma cause many births? This also has a problem of simultaneity. That means one karma is giving you horse's birth. Simultaneously, your one karma is giving you rat's birth. Simultaneously, so one karma for one birth and many karmas getting exhausted at one time, that is also a philosophical absurdity. So that leaves with only one choice. And the one choice is, there is a bunch of karmas taken from karmashaya. That means from the Sanchita, a bunch of it called Prarabdham is taken out and the Jati Ayubhoga starts. So for one birth, a bunch of karmas, the word uses Ek Praghattakena Yugapat. Praghattika means what? In the olden days, on the roof of the houses, they used to have a tile, earthen tile on the top. That earthen tile used to be called Gattika. As if, in Hindi it is called Khappad. Supposing that one Khappad Bharke, or that tile full, in other words, a bunch of karmas are taken from the karmashaya and then the birth starts. So the most logical, most tarkic explanation of relationship between karma and the birth is, in one birth, a bunch of karmas are taken and exhausted in one birth. So the birth is meant for exhaustion of the previous karmas. It is a different story that we create multiple karmas again in this birth. So what happens is, there is a person who has been asked to retire the loan that he has taken in the past. So he goes to the city for one day, that is one birth, to exhaust the loan. But in the process, what happens? He creates further loan. So again, he is sent to the city. Again, he works and actually creates more loan than what he was supposed to give back. So every birth, we keep on ripping the karmas. And this vicious cycle, Punarapi Jananam, Punarapi Maranam, this is what Shankaracharya was pointing out. And a yogi, because he is ready to exhaust the karmas, and how does it exhaust the karmas? He is not going to have multiple good lives and then exhaust the karmas. No, in one life he does it. How he does it? He does it with a very, very, very important strategy. And the strategy is, he says that my new karmas, I should not be creating. Agreed. But even if I don't create my new karmas, my old karmas are so many that I will be born for millions of births. What about that? Then Patanjali Maharaj says, Klesha Rupi Moolaha, you exhaust the Klesha. Once the klesha is exhausted, even if the karmas are standing there, there is no taker now. there is a man who is having a lot of loan on his head from different banks. They came to collect it, but the man is dead. He's gone. What will they do? They will write off the loan. Similarly, Karmashaya is still there. But when they come to that particular person, he has already removed all the kleshas. And when the kleshas are not there, there is no person to whom this can be ascribed. Why? Because that person has won over the kleshas. Such a person is called Jnani in Advaita. Jnanagni sarva karmani bhasmasat kurute. This is the meaning of that particular aphorism. What it means is, there is a house, but there is no landlord. Now, whether the house comes down, crumbles, prospers, it is of no significance because the landlord has left the house. That is why Patanjali Yoga Sutra gives an absolute strategic answer to this entire vicious circle, that work on your kleshas. And working on kleshas is what precisely Ashtanga Yoga is. Depending upon how many kleshas you have, I mean, you will be having all the five kleshas, but how strong the kleshas are. Stronger the kleshas, do Ashtanga Yoga, Yama Niyama, Dharana, Asana, Pratyahara. They are loosened kleshas, do Kriya Yoga. They are too weak and loosened now, do Samadhi. And burn the seed of the kleshas. Once the seed of the kleshas is burnt, that so-called pool of karmas and karmashayas, the Lord has no choice but to dump it in the sea because there is no taker. Panchi, the bird has flown away. Ud jayega hans akela. Jag darshan ka mela. Now he knows the world as only something like a drama. Yam ke doot bade majboot, yam se pada jamela, ud jayega hans akela. Kabir Maharaj says, only one paramahamsa will be out of all this rut or the circle, vicious cycle. So this is about the karma. Then comes the possibility that if the kleshas are destroyed, let us take example of Gurudeva himself. Gurudeva has burnt the kleshas in 1948, 49. We don't know the year because nothing is mentioned about it. One particular night or day when he was sitting in that meditative posture where his samadhi went into a sampradnyat samadhi, that was the time all his kleshas were burnt. Now comes the question, if the kleshas are burnt, then how is it that he could work thereafter? Because working thereafter was a karma. How is it that he was able to continue? That means, in other words, when a Jivan Mukta completely destroys the Klesha, the Karmashaya is gone, that is fine. But already started Prarabdha also should be over and he should be dead. It doesn't happen. It appears he's still working. It appears he's still suffering. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa had a throat cancer. When he is not having any Klesha, how did the cancer came? And the answer for that is that when the Karmashaya Vipaka starts, when the fructification of karma starts, then even if kleshas are absent, it will continue till the phalams are complete. In other words, till the prarabdha is complete, midway, even if there is a Jivan Mukta, he has to undergo the prarabdha because the wheel is already set into the motion. And the example analogy given is of a potter's wheel. A potter is making a pot. After the pot is made and last pot is also made, the wheel keeps still rotating. Why? He's not moving it, but it has already undertaken some speed. With that speed, till it becomes zero, it will keep on moving. Similarly, as the karma vipaka has already started with the birth, even for Jivan Mukta, even though he is Jivan Mukta, he shall continue to do the prarabdha karmas till his death. After the death, there is no birth. So, that is the reason why a person with Viveka Khyati or a Jnani has still prarabdham. Because Klesha Satta is anivarya at the beginning of Karmashaya Phala Prarambham, but not for continuity. So that means if you have Klesha, then only you will be born. But once you are born, then only the fructification will continue. Next birth is not possible for a yogi because there is no Klesha left anymore. So Jati Ayu Bhoga Jati is not there. So fructification of karma called karma phala vipaka has jati ayu bhoga. That means a janma, you will be born. The very act of getting born is the first effect of karma phala vipaka or fructification of karma. Second, ayu, you will be having certain period. And bhoga, sukha, dukha, moha, rupi, shabda, vritti is bhoga. So these three are the one as a gift, it will come to you as a fructification of karma. So karmashaya is called trivipakatmaka. Trivipaka means jati, ayu, bhoga. And it is also called ekabhavika. Ekabhavika means capable of giving one birth. So in the pool of karmas, called karma ashaya, a bunch that is taken out is called trivipakatmak. It will give jati, ayu, bhoga, it will give birth, it will give you certain extent of life, and it will give you certain good and bad experiences. And it will be responsible for one birth. After one birth, the bunch that was taken out is over. It's done with. It's a different story that we have created another bunch during the janma. That is a different story altogether. As far as one is concerned, your one day's labor is done. While doing the labor, you neglected the duty, so you'll be given another 2 days' duty. That is a different story. But your one day's labor is over. Your one birth is over. Drushta janma vedaniya, or the current karma, it can be eka vipaka prada, dvi vipaka prada. Now, what I am trying to make is a difference between karmashaya and the life which has already started. In our case, our life has already started maybe 40, 50 years back. We were born. Because this is drushta janma vedaniya, that means current life, it is only having either, because janma is already done. What is left? Bhoga and ayu. So current vedaniya, drushta janma vedaniya karma, or the current life has got only two aspects. One is ayu and bhoga. What about janma? Janma is already done. So it is a dvi vipaka prada. But sometimes it can be eka vipaka prada also. How? If you are born as in swarga, as a deva, deva doesn't have ayu. They continue. There is a life and life only. There is no death. But bhoga are there. So it is eka vipaka prada. Why? Because if you have very too much of punya karma, you will be born as a devas in swarga. Whatever yaksha, kinnara, whatever, you will be born in denizens, citizens of the netherworld, citizens of the swarga. Citizen of the swarga doesn't have death. We have seen it in Kathopanishad when Yamadharmaraj tells to Nachiketa that Nachiketa, there is only Tarunya. There is no Vruddhavastha. So to such people, only Bhog is possible. So it is Ek Vipak. For us, Dvi Vipak, Bhog and Ayu. Why? We are already born. And for my, those karmas from which the birth is yet to take place, Tri Vipakatma. From my collection of my karmas, three things will happen. Ayu, jati, bhoga. When? Whenever that bunch will be taken out for the next birth. And after this comes a very important aspect of vasana and karmashaya. Mind well, vasanas are different and karmashaya is different. What is karmashaya? That which has been taken out for births. That which has been taken out. For example, let us say you bring a wheat flour in the house to make chapati. That flour is there in the bag. Of that, you take some bunch of flour and make the dough. Atta banate. You make the dough. Of that, you take a small part of dough and make the chapati, one chapati out of it. So what has happened? There is a flour, there is a dough, and there is a chapati. Mind well, chapati is the current birth. Dough is already prepared. So dough will not go waste. You have to make chapati. That means the dough is capable of giving birth. So dough is called karmashaya. And what is the flour? The flour is called vasana. That is the difference between vasana, karmashaya, and the current birth. Or drushta janma vedaniya karma. I hope it is clear. So that means flour, you can convert it into dough. And then from that you can make a chapati. In other words, vasana can be converted into karmashaya. Karmashaya will be then, because whatever flower you take out of the vasana collection is karmashaya. That karmashaya is then ready for making multiple births or one birth. Because if you take this much of dough, you will make only one chapati. Or if you take this much of dough you may make 10 chapatis. That means prarabdha can give rise to birth, to one birth or maybe 10 births. We always have a wrong notion that one prarabdha, one birth. No, a prarabdha can have pack of births. Because it is now out for delivery. It could be one thing or it could be 10 things. But as far as flour is concerned, it has capacity to make the dough. Now what happens in case of yogi? Because he is no more hungry. He is no more hungry. That chapati which is already being made is eaten by him. It is not that he stops eating that chapati. So that birth he continues to live. But the remaining dough is gone. The flour is also gone. Why? The appetite is gone. That is why vasanas are called aneka janma bhava purvika. That means the one that has potential to give many births. The flour has capacity to make many chapatis but not yet made. While karmashaya is called ek bhavika samskara. That means karmashaya is something which can give rise to births. This is the difference between this samskara, which is basically karmashaya, and vasana. So certain fundamental aspects should be very clear to us. One is, there is a karma-janya samskar for every karma that leads to collection of karmas called karmashaya, and each karma creates a vasana. So out of the vasanas that are created, out of the desires that we have, each desire creates a vasana, and that repetitive desire becomes vasana, and the vasanas keeps on increasing. Out of the vasanas, part of the vasanas taken out as karmashaya, and it is decided that these will be exhausted now by births or birth. It could be for one birth, it could be for multiple births, it could be 5, it could be 10. So a pack of births follows. Those 10 births or 12 births or 20 births need not be identical. It could be human, rat, dog, cat, again human, depending upon what kind of karmashaya is distributed in each drushta janma vedaniya karma or the birth or the current birth. This is how the karmashaya, after this karmashaya is exhausted, again some vasanas are taken, a new karmashaya is formed. And this cycle, it continues unabated for millions and billions and billions of years. And during the evolution, if the Lord decides to withdraw the Prakriti, the whole universe is destroyed by Shiva and the whole thing comes into the seed form. All these vasanas go into the Sukshma Bija Rupa and lie dormant there for how long? As long as the Lord wants, which is called Brahma Ratra. When Brahmadeva is sleeping, everybody's samskaras go there and vasanas go and lie in dormant seed form. When Praja Prasrushti is again starting, everybody comes back with their respective load of those seeds that were there, and from the seed sprouts again the cycle starts. This has been going on for anadi. Because avidya is anadi. So it has been there. Never ask how long back it started. It is simply difficult for us to imagine how long back the avidya has started, how long back this janma maranam has started. But it is there. It is a fact. That is why Siddhartha Gautam Buddha said, even if I know when it started, it is not going to make any difference to me. All I want to know is how can I end it. So Ashtanga Patha that he started was basically to bring to an end the life which is nothing else but sorrow. The life is full of sorrow, which is the first truth amongst the golden truths of Buddhas. Is an attempt to end it. That is why he was never interested into any speculative philosophical things like whether Atma is there, Anatma is there, whether there is a rebirth, whether he spoke very little about them. He spoke practically about how can you end the cycle of birth and death or the sorrow and birth. That is how this 13th mantra is very important. Again, amongst these karma ashayas, how these karmas operate? Is it possible that you do a good karma and you try to nullify a bad karma? Yes, it is possible. How it can be done? Is it possible that a smaller karma gets absorbed into the bigger karma and then you can experience that? It is possible. So we will have to see different types or possibilities of Aniyata Vipaka and Niyata Vipaka. What is Niyata Vipaka? That which is destined to give you births. And that which is not yet destined, but it is still lying there, which is called as Drushta Janma Vedaniya Aniyata Vipaka. Very long word. That means that which is not yet fructified and about whose fate nothing is decided. It is just lying dormant. In other words, the bag full of flour which is lying there, we don't know whether I'll be making chapati or not. I don't know when I'll be using that atta or not. Nothing can be said about it at the moment. But it can be utilized in a particular manner. Either I will throw the atta, I will make the dough out of it, or I will keep it as it is. Similarly, the old karmas that are outstanding there in the warehouse as a sanchita, karmashaya is prarabdha. That is anyway, that is bound to be going on. That cannot be stopped. But sanchita, what will happen to those accumulated karmas is specifically defined in Patanjali Yoga Shastra, the details of which we shall see into the next class. Hari Om.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnam Udachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti, Shantihi, Harihi Om Shri Grubhyo Namaha, Harihi Om.
Hari Om Sanjay ji, thank you for that And if anyone has any questions, please unmute yourself and ask the question. I think Meenakshi ji has some.
Hariom, Sanjay ji. Sanjay ji, two questions. One is the verse 12, the printouts which we have from Swami Vivekananda. In the explanation that he's given, he's spoken about the food and energy coming in from sun. Why would he want to accommodate this? There has to be a reason why he has accommodated this in this verse. That's one. Second is, it's I mean, from my intelligence level, I find this at a very, it's at the periphery. Everything is just, it's an outline, you know. It doesn't give practical solutions. So when, as much as I was looking forward to knowing about the concentration and its practice, it just talks very, very high philosophy, which probably, from my understanding, it's very, is it going to continue this way? Is this the way it is going to, or does it come down to practical levels and how things are done in general life and how we focus and how we concentrate? Or, you know, it's a lot of theory for me over.
I would rather put it as the most practical way of looking at it. When it is said in this discussion that we had today, it very clearly states that when we are talking of kleshas, the name in Sanskrit might sound little jargonish, but the fact is very simple. In fact, it is one of the most practical thing that you can find in, otherwise the Samadhi Pada is too theoretical for us because we have not reached that stage. But this theory of karma that we are talking about gives an absolute practical hints. It can't be more practical than this. What it says is that every samskar that we are doing is either going to be papatmaka or punyatmaka. So either we have in our daily life a tendency to satisfy ourselves or to satisfy others. Is there anything else that we do in our life? Nothing. So when you try to satisfy others by sacrificing yourself, it becomes a punya karma. And when you try to satisfy yourself, it becomes a papa karma because you are getting falling prey to the vishayas. And every time you fall prey to the vishayas, you become used to it. So oft repetitive doing things which really pacifies you through the indriyas, it leads to a kind of a tendency in you. So you have likes and dislikes. So it gives a very practical hint that if you, this is what I'm talking in terms of what can be termed as a vyavaharika goshta. Then let us talk about something which is avyavaharika. For example, troubling others, beating others, shouting at others, killing others. Anyway, those are papatmaka karya. Do not do that. Why? Because it is explaining us how karma works. What more practicality one can require out of it. So in your day-to-day life, it can be implemented in the most practical manner, in the sense that every act that you do, try to look at it, what that act is all about. For example, you are looking after your children because that is your duty. Fair enough. Now the question is, while you are exercising that duty, are you doing it with some kind of desire in your mind? If it is desireless activity, then naturally it doesn't have any potential of creating any klesha. That means your karma is not creating any kind of seed into it of your, for your future fructification. This is precisely what we are talking about, nishkama karma seva. When a mother feeds the baby, is it not a nishkama karma seva? It is. But when the same child should be listening to me and should look after me and my child, then what happens? The desire is started creeping in. My child has to be first amongst the class and others he should excel with. What is happening is now it is taking the shape of desires. So practical hints are anyway fully inbuilt into it. Try to avoid all the kleshas. One of the easiest way to explain this is, and what are the kleshas? Raga, dvesha, asmita, abhinivesha, avidya. Forget about abhinivesha. We are not thinking of death at all. Forget about your avidya. But asmita, raga, dvesha is the most practical. What is asmita? Ego. Think about your own behavior every day. How much is your ego? Somebody didn't invite you. Somewhere you are not given importance. My husband doesn't behave properly with me. Why? Because I feel I should be behaved, I should be treated in a proper manner. There is an ego involved in me. And my friends are not treating me properly. Second thing is, my child does not really respect the way he should be respecting the mom. He is उल्टा बोलता है. ही इज टॉकिंग अगेंस्ट मी, आई एम एंग्री विथ हिम. एट द एंड ईगो इज प्लेइंग इट्स रोल एवरीवेयर. सो अस्मिता, राग द्वेष, थ्रू आउट द डे फाइंड आउट हाउ मेनी टाइम्स व्हाट यू आर डूइंग. आइदर यू आर हैप्पी और अनहैप्पी, दैट मीन्स यू आर गेटिंग फ्लोन विथ समथिंग और यू आर गेटिंग एब्सर्डिटी अबाउट समथिंग. You want to avoid something, you have aversion about something. This is what the Yoga Sutra is trying to tell you to avoid. So, for example, you are eating your food every day. How many times you say, I don't like this sabji, I don't like that? What is that aversion? What more practicality one requires from Patanjali Yoga Shastra? Start eating all your food without complaining anything, with a complete understanding in the mind that the Yoga Shastra tells me not to be averse to anything. Yes, you may avoid certain things which are detrimental to your growth. That is not aversion. But aversion is not accepting the current situation. So these are all practical hints. That is why this is, in fact, Patanjali Yoga Sutra overall talks about those states of mind which are far away from our reach. But when it comes to this discussion of karma, etc., he is now flowing down. As we move forward to Yama, Niyama, etc., he is still going to come down because those are preliminary exercises. And now the question from your side would be, all right, I heard about kleshas, but I want some practical hints. How can I do it? That is what is going to come when we will be studying Ashtanga Yoga. When you study Yama, when you study Niyama, we all say that in our daily professional life, you have to be disciplined. And because disciplined people are extraordinary people, what is discipline you are talking about? In your business, you want to pay your taxes on time. You pay salaries on time. You check your invoices on time. What is this on-time business? Yama Niyama. So in practical life, you are using the same thing only for a vested interest. Here it is at a much higher elaborate level. You continue the same thing. Every morning, I shall get up at so-and-so time. What are you trying to do? Just getting up doesn't make anything. But by getting up, you are trying to train your mind to be disciplined. So there are enormous amount of practical hints in discussions that we do. Only thing is, we are trying to see the fundamentals of these discussions, because when you understand anything and implement, it is always a strong foundation. Just because somebody says, how many times you have been told that please speak truth? How many times we spoke? Rarely. The reason being, we hear from one ear and leave it from the other ear. But fundamental understanding when you have, I can definitely vouch for it, that it leads to enormous amount of understanding, and then your behavior takes a very firm foundation. So it is full of practical tips. It is definitely not elusive, or it is not too ephemeral or that kind of a thing. It has very, very practical hints. Our focus, of course, is understanding more the foundations. So that is why Punya Karma? Why go to temple? Why think of Lord? Why take his name? All that gets explained when you see these karmas. Just now we said Devarshi Aradhana is Dharma Krutya. Why Dharma Krutya you require? Because it will nullify the Papa Krutya. When it nullifies the Papa Krutya, what will happen? At least you will have Sattva Guna in you. That Sattva Guna is required to then study the Shastras. Then while studying the Shastras, the Sattva Guna will grow. Then that Satoguna will help you, propel you to go for Samadhi. Because without Satoguna, nothing happens. That means everything has to be done to inculcate Satoguna. Karma is meant for creating Satoguna. So it is giving practical hints how to create the Satoguna. So there is a lot of relevance into it. And as far as Swami Vivekananda's explanation is concerned, he is trying to now give a macroscopic view about our presence. You being a part of the entire cosmos, if you look at everything, everybody is sustaining you. We always have a feeling that I am an isolated person and I am working in this world. The world is working on you and for you. So that is the reason why you are alive and the way you are working. So that being the reason, you have to be thankful to your red blood cells because they are breathing for you. You have to be thankful to your lungs because they are breathing for you. You have to be thankful to the heart because it is pumping blood for you. In that manner, in that ecclesiastical thinking, the whole harmony of the Virata Purusha or the Hiranyagarbha comes to the mind. So as far as practicality is concerned, there is enormous amount of practicality. And if there is any question regarding a specific issue that we are facing, then it is better to bring it in the form of question so that we can relate and correlate it with the discussion that is going on. In case of Samadhipada, I can understand. It was far beyond, it is bound to sound theoretical. Because tomorrow, if you are taught about the astrophysics, we have no foundation about it. We have not gone to the laboratories, etc. Naturally, it will sound gibberish or jargonish. So that is why Samadhipada is more difficult to understand. But Sadhanapada is practical. So here, it is the best part is to have more and more questions, more and more discussion, so that it becomes more clear to us. Hari Om.
Sanjay ji, you know, we talk about there's also this Shadripu or Arishtava that we talk about, right? So here we took only four today, but there are normally two more, which that Madh and Matsarya. What is there any reason why that has not been considered here?
Yeah, these are actually byproducts of these four. The four are considered because the Matsar again is basically only when you have a lobha, the Matsar comes. One is presence and one is absence. So Matsar is basically aversion. You know, you are not liking something. That's the reason why the whole thing has come to your mind of hating somebody. Jealousy is a byproduct of not liking something. So that is why from the very fundamental point of view, kama, because desire has to be there. Krodha, because you're not getting what you want. Lobha, because you are wanting something to have. So, and moha, greed. So in these four, what happens basically is you are essentially trying to fundamentally concise them into four. In case of lobha and moha, there is slightly difference. The moha is the enticement. So enticement is the first reaction of an indriya to any vishaya. Lobha is only after the experience. So one is post-experience state, one is pre-experience state. And that happens by analogy. Suppose you ate jalebi, and right besides that, there is a new substance which you don't know, but it is a sweetmeat shop. You will feel like trying that also. So there is a moha created out of experience of something else which may be similar or identical. So that is why kama is the mother of everything, desire. Because if kama is not there, lobha cannot work, nothing can work. Krodha is when you don't get what you are desiring. So that is where krodha comes. Now, krodha can take different shapes. Matsara is a type of a krodha. Matsara is a type of a krodha. The only difference is when you don't get what you want, you get what is called as explicit krodha. But matsara is when someone else has got what you think he should not get. That is matsara. So those are nothing else but the ancillaries to these basic four. Hari.
Sanjay, one more thing on, you know, the various births that we see that you can become a human and then you can become an animal, etc. Just some clarification, because there's a gradation. I'm just trying to understand. Obviously, if you have evolved over a period of time, then you are expected to, you know, behave in a particular manner or evolve at a higher species. How does one explain going back?
Yes, that's because the antakkarana vikas, if you look at it as a graded affair, the highest antakkarana vikas is in human body. Now, it is like this, that somebody who has learning to use the implements in attack has been taught everything, and ultimately he has been given a sword, because that is the highest instrument to be used. And suppose now he takes the sword in his hand, he will be able to kill all the enemies because sword is the most powerful, because others were using only stick. And with stick, an enemy cannot be killed. But with a sword, he can be killed. So that is how what has happened. That person who was training has now reached a stage where he was given a sword to kill. Now he took the sword to kill. But what he did is he started cutting his own fingers. Now it is not the fault of the sword. It is the fault of the usage of the sword. Instead of using it for the purpose it was meant, it has been used for a wrong purpose. So antakkaran vikas, when it reaches human level, the antakkaran vikas is supposed to be now to jump forward towards the godliness. So from human to God is the expected journey. But what happens? Because now the antakkaran vikas is there, the person has ability to use it in a full manner. And then what he tries to do is he tries to use that through indriyas for all the vishayas. So the sword is getting misused. Antakarana vikas is getting misused. As a result of that, what happens? The person loses the eligibility to have antakarana vikas. In such a case, because of the tendencies that he developed at this stage, he is taken back to the place where the tendencies match. For example, there is a murderer. So it is a murderer is what? It is a hyusaka pravrutti. So hyusaka pravrutti, then that tendency of hyusaka pravrutti vasana puts him back into a species where hyusaka pravrutti is there. So he becomes a tiryaki yoni. He becomes a violent animal. Similarly, somebody who is using this antakarana vikas for too much of tossing and turning, rajogunatmaka, such a chanchal ayushya that one person spends, he again gets degraded down where chanchalta is dominant, the birth of a monkey, a chanchalta. Then there are people who keep hoarding the things, and that too by stealing from somebody. A person of such caliber shall be born into similar tendency, which is a tendency of a mice or a rat, to nibble everything and store it in its own place. So that is how, based on the pravrutti, pravrutti is the resultant of the vasana. Vasanas are coming from the karma, and the karma is coming from the antakkarana. So when down below when you go, that time you have only bhoga yuni, because that is what the tendency has brought you there. So they exhaust their tendencies, but they do not create any papa karma, because of which slowly the chitta again becomes purer, and they again come towards the human level. So from human level to go down, to go up, it all depends upon how you utilize the antakkarana. Now, if antakkarana is not developed to the level of human being, there is no chance of you utilizing viveka and vairagya. So that is why human birth is considered supreme, but misused and disused by the human beings, leading to again the lower births, again coming up. This is what is called as either evolution of the creation or involution of consciousness. Hari Om.
Hari Om ji. One last thing, you know, if we go back into, you know, as you progress in this evolution, and there's greater sattva-guna, and there's, you know, there's obviously, when we talk of mudita and, you know, concern for everybody, etc., right? So this should actually be the evolution of in the journey, right? There's the more sattva-guna we... But then I'm just saying there are historical events also, right? Let's say, for example, you know, there was Zoroastrianism that was there, right? Which is a very old religion, but it... When Islam came there, it took probably 10 years to convert that entire country from, you know, Zoroastrianism into Islamic. Now, similarly, I'm just trying to think of instances. Like 200 BC, we had Nalanda, we had Takshila, we had all those universities of extremely high caliber. I mean, yet you have one, and obviously the people who are going there are of a higher caliber who are, you know, who have more love for human beings and knowledge, etc. Then you meet barbarians in life who, you know, destroy everything, right? So what is the cause of all this? Is it, you know, karma? Is it, how does one deal with situations? Because it's not the optimal, right? One would assume that if you're going on the path, you should be protected. I mean, by the divinity itself. How is this explained?
See, this is again what we discussed today was an individual and his karma. Now, we have not discussed combination of individuals and their cumulative karmas. Let us talk about a community. A community is comprising of many individuals, and in the community, each individual is carrying a certain set of karmas with it. Now, supposing that all such people who have come together, let us say there are 50 or 100 people who have perpetrated a crime. That means all 100 participated in adharmika krutya, so papa karma. Now all those are responsible for what has happened, and they shall pay for it in the form of fructification of karma. Now imagine those 100 are supposed to suffer equal amount of pain or equal amount of dukkham from the oppressed or from any other source. Fructification, when it happens, all the 100 have to be together at one place. Because for that particular karma, which they have cumulatively committed, they will be cumulatively paying for. Actually, it is individual who is paying for his individual debt. But because the debts are common, they are all put and lumped together for the fructification of karma. When such a thing happens, then that community suffers. When that happens at a little larger level, then the state suffers. It is still at a larger level, the country suffers. So that is how you see the Utsarpini and Anusarpini, the upward movement and the downward movement of different places. That is why it is called as a prarabdham of an island, a prarabdham of a bhubhaga. A place where we are settling now, where we are in now in Gulf, was a place where there was only ramal, the only sand was there everywhere. In no time, it became a prosperous place because the prosperity, the punya karma of this bhubhaga has started flourishing. India was a sparrow of gold. That is why how it she was described for almost 2000 years, because that was the bhubhaga prarabdha. Then from 13th century onwards, especially in 17th, 18th and British occupation, it became one of the poorest and the most exploited, famine affected country. This is again what is called as the prarabdha bhagyam of that particular nation in that particular point of time. The United States became the most prosperous and powerful nation for last 100 years. But in the kaleidoscope of history, it was the most neglected continent for thousands of years. So there is something called individual prarabdham, cumulative prarabdham of the community in which such individuals are there. And then there is again a prarabdham of the country, etc. As far as places like Nalanda and other things are concerned, mind well, when they were attacked and assaulted by this thing, you are forgetting that it could be the last fructification or phalam of the karma of the monk that was sitting there. The death of a monk like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was through a cancer. The whole demonstration given by the Lord in the form of avatar of Lord Ramakrishna Paramahamsa is that all your accumulated karmas were exhausted by one shot of one cancer in the throat. In fact, Ramakrishna himself said that this throat is nothing else. Kali Mata told me that all the papam that I took from my devotees all got accumulated here because their papam, I suffered. Their prarabdham, I took it on myself and that came in the form of a cancer. So he cumulatively suffered everybody's papam to whom he gave his blessings. So similarly, when it comes to these different stories, what we hear, we need not always think that as how this happened to them. This could be the end of certain things. I am aware of certain saintly people who have been killed by tiger, mauled by tiger and they died. So it looks like this. How can an enlightened person be mauled by a tiger? It is not that. It is perhaps the last trace of karma that was left was taken over. Swami Vivekananda suffered from 21 diseases. This could be perhaps a complete wiping out of the remaining karmas that were there and there was no fructification thereafter. Because in prarabdham, see, a prarabdham, it can be destroyed without suffering. We are going to come to that in the next class. But prarabdham, that which is initiated, has to be finished in some manner or the other. So that is why the manner in which a thing is happening is not easy to decipher. It is not easy to decipher how karma works. That is why it is called karmana gahano gati. The most mysterious way of the karma acts. Is Mirabai to be blamed for a very bad karma that she left the palace? Or is she to be admired because she became a saintly person? Outlook varies. But yes, she did suffer. Gandhiji suffered all his life. He was imprisoned M number of times. Was it because it was a bad karma? Or was it because he was exhausting his karmas? It all depends because it's a part of purification. Purificatory procedure that is happening in case of a jnani, because millions of years of pangs are to be removed from the seeds. It's not an easy process. So that is the reason why we do get something which looks outwardly absurd, but still happening. Hari Om.